Hello everyone and welcome to Dragalia Foundry, a fan channel where everything Dragalia Lost can be found. This video is a beginner's guide to Dragalia Lost as of January 2021. Dragalia Lost is an action RPG for mobile devices that initially launched in September 2018. Thanks to its rich combat and story, generous stamina and summoning systems, as well as a responsive development team, the game has amassed a modest but dedicated following over the past few years. Dragalia Lost continues to improve with new version updates and highly produced events releasing each month, and that's alongside its deep offering of permanent content, so there's no time like the present to jump in. In this video, I'll walk you through everything I'd want to know as a new player checking out Dragalia Lost for the first time in 2021. Of course, with Dragalia Lost constantly evolving, at some point this video will become outdated. My best recommendation for a more frequently updated text guide to accompany this video is linked to in the description below. The guide I link to is revised frequently over on the game's wiki. The Dragalia Lost wiki is a fantastic resource that I highly recommend using for new players to Dragalia Lost. A big thank you to all of its contributors. With that being said, let's get started with this video guide. There's a lot to cover, so timestamps are available on the video and in the description if you wish to skip around. And as you can tell by the video length, I've tried to be as thorough as possible, but there will still be things left unsaid. Once you have created a new account and done some tutorial summons, you'll be prompted to build a team and start clearing quests from the main campaign. Beating Chapter 7 of the campaign should be your next priority as a new player, since some game modes are locked until then. As you progress through the campaign, you'll learn the ins and outs of Dragalia Lost combat mechanics and complete tutorials on other core systems like facilities and the Halidom, and crafting and equipment. You can choose to skip to Chapter 11 of the campaign, collecting nearly all rewards in the process, but I don't recommend this for brand new players because story quests are ideal for practicing and learning how to maneuver, dodge, and force strike using the game's touch controls, which do have a learning curve. If you're a returning player with a new account, feel free to skip ahead. The only drawback at that point is to those who want to carefully manage their stamina, used for solo play, and Gather Wings, used for co-op. As you'll learn by playing through the campaign, in combat you control a lead adventurer and can swap to other adventurers on your team at any time by tapping their portrait or by rotating through them in order by tapping the portrait of your active unit. Tap the screen to perform standard attacks with your lead adventurer. Different weapon types have different basic attack patterns, and as your hits land, you'll slowly fill up gauges used to cast your skills. Within the community, the amount of skill charge you get from basic attacks is referred to as SP, and every skill has an SP cost, indicating how many basic attacks you must perform before it's ready for use. Most weapon types have a basic combo consisting of 5 taps, and the later hits of the combo generate the most SP, meaning it's good to stay in place and perform full combos against bosses when possible. Exceptions are sword units, which prefer to do 1-3 quick hits, then force strike, and mana casters, which tend to intersperse their shots with dodge rolls in order to ready up their next shot more quickly. Skills vary in their SP cost as well as how much damage they deal, and even then, other factors like abilities and synergies can matter more in deciding which adventurers are best for a given situation. To use a skill, you simply tap its icon. When a skill is used, the adventurer who used it gains invulnerability from most red and untelegraphed enemy attacks. This temporary period of invincibility is referred to by players as iframes. Iframes apply to the adventurer who uses a skill for the entire duration of their skill animation, but they also apply to any AI-controlled teammates you have for a shorter duration, roughly while the skill user's portrait cuts in on screen. Purple enemy attacks and enemy attacks with crosshairs, unlike red and yellow attacks, cannot be iframed. These must be dodged by moving out of the way, or in rare cases, by using a skill that jumps. If you have trouble making out the screen with all the visual flourish that skills bring to the game, you can opt to set visual effects to basic from the options menu in the top right corner of the homepage. As far as how damage works, you'll see numbers pop on screen when you use skills or perform basic attacks. Damage can appear in yellow, white, or a dull, faded white, and this indicates whether or not you have an elemental advantage, are dealing neutral damage, or are dealing reduced damage to a foe. In Dragalia Lost, water is strong against flame is strong against wind, and wind is strong against water. Light light is strong against shadow and shadow is strong against light, but that matchup always resolves in the player's favor. And strong against in this context means both dealing extra damage to and receiving reduced damage from. The main stat that boosts damage is strength, but other abilities like skill damage and critical damage can contribute to your overall damage per second or DPS as well. Adventurers wielding ranged weapons, including bows, wands, staves, and mana casters, have lower defenses than melee adventurers, only 80% of what they have, and they take extra damage as a result. Just like with adventurers, enemy defenses and their elemental weaknesses also vary from boss to boss, quest to quest, and chapter to chapter. If you are struggling at all during the campaign, try to use adventurers of the one or two elements which have an advantage against the quest you're attempting. And if you ever fail a quest in Dragalia Lost, in the campaign or otherwise, don't worry, you won't lose stamina or gather wings and can retry it at any point. Within the campaign, each chapter contains various stage hazards which can induce afflictions. Afflictions are debilitating status effects like burn, poison, paralysis, blindness, stun, sleep, bog, and so on, which can be applied to your party members or against enemies depending on their resistances. All adventurers have at least one affliction resistance built into their second ability slots, and this can make clearing the campaign easier. Some adventurers have the ability to heal HP and cleanse afflictions too, including Cleo. Healers are pretty safe inclusions on a team if you hit a roadblock during the campaign. Whereas damage scales off strength, healing scales primarily off of HP and secondarily off of strength. When it comes to boss enemies, initial affliction resistance varies, but every time you successfully afflict a boss, it will build up extra tolerance to the affliction you use. Bosses tend to build up this tolerance to damage over time afflictions in 5 percentage point increments, blindness tolerance 10 points at a time, and tolerance to immobilizing afflictions builds up more rapidly, in 20 percentage point chunks. This is designed to prevent bosses from being exploited by the same powerful affliction repeatedly, but this tends to come up more in the end game than the early game. One thing that will come up more often throughout the game is that when bosses enter a state called Overdrive, they cleanse all afflictions they have. Bosses in Dragalia Lost have three modes or states: Normal, Overdrive, and Break. Most begin battle in the normal state, and a gauge below their HP bar called the Mode Gauge fills up as you deal damage and do battle. When the gauge is completely full, the bosses enter Overdrive, cleansing all of their afflictions and powering up their stats. Sometimes bosses will also have different move patterns within Overdrive. As you deal damage, you'll see the mode gauge decrease, and when it's empty, you have broken the boss. The break state is very short in duration, but most bosses are immobilized and damage to them is boosted significantly. This is your opportunity to unleash as many skills as possible and deal damage uninhibited. Bosses can be broken faster by using Force Strikes, a special move performed by holding down on the screen, aiming, and releasing. Force Strikes are also used to break enemy shields. As a tip, Force Strikes are much easier to perform and aim if you turn off 180 and 90 degree turns within the game options. Some bosses are so dangerous during their Overdrive state that you'll want to do nothing else but Force Strike to try rush them to break as fast as possible. Once break ends, bosses return to their normal state. More often though, you'll just want to continue as normal during Overdrive with the occasional Force Strike thrown in. As you see the mode gauge get closer to zero, you may want to conserve skills for use after break initiates. Another option to pile on damage during break, or even to diminish Overdrive faster, is shapeshifting or transforming into a dragon. In Dragalia Lost, dragons are a form of gear or equipment whose abilities or aura can provide passive benefits to the adventurer they're equipped to. But besides their passive use, dragons also grant an additional in-combat option. By clicking on a dragon's portrait when the dragon gauge is at or above 50%, you can shapeshift into that dragon for a limited time. You fill up the gauge by dealing damage, demolishing boss parts, defeating lesser enemies, and breaking dragon obelisks. Dragons usually have stronger standard attacks than adventurers, but their dragon skill is limited to one use only, or sometimes two uses, meaning their total DPS can be worse than that of an adventurer. Still, dragons are immune to damage, with enemy attacks only eating into your total shapeshift duration, so dragons are plenty useful, especially during the early to mid game. In late game play, dragon usage can be more technical and complicated, but from a campaign standpoint, using your dragons against harder enemies called menaces or against bosses should be a perfectly viable strategy. try match the element of the dragons you equip to your adventurers when possible, at least in the early game, for the best results. Some of the last combat lessons you'll learn from the story pertain to things like dodging, bracing, and targeting. In addition to timing skills to iframe enemy attacks, all adventurers have a dodge roll move you can use simply by swiping the screen. This move is good to cover your lead and quickly reposition yourself, although unlike skills, dodge rolling does not grant iframes to your AI teammates, just to your lead unit who performed the roll. Another technique, bracing, is basically an aerial tech. When enemy moves knock you in the air, you can tap so that you do not fall to the ground and instead rebound immediately in the air. You can also set this to automatically happen for AI teammates using a toggle in the options menu. And finally, targeting refers to the reticle or circle you'll see under an enemy. When you've targeted an enemy, it's harder to run away fast, but your own moves and those of your AI teammates will automatically lock on to that enemy. Enemies can also target adventurers, and during some of their attacks, you'll see the boss enemy point toward a certain unit, indicating they have its attention. More advanced play involves baiting and manipulating foes this way. To just clear the campaign, you don't need to know this much about combat, but the campaign is a great place to train and hone your skills as you familiarize yourself with Dragalia Lost and its combat system. On normal difficulty, the campaign is one and done content. Once you clear a level, that's it. If you're not into the story, you can always skip ahead and read a summary of what you skipped. Not Super Rad Plot Synopsis, a comic published to sum up the story that's linked to from within the game, is another way to follow along. Most of the campaign can be done at your leisure, but to get a jump start on time-sensitive content, finishing Chapter 7 is key. That's because completing Chapter 6 unlocks the Imperial Onslaught, a mode intended for daily play, and Chapter 7 unlocks Void Battles, an important permanent mode with monthly rewards. When you complete Chapter 7 of the main campaign, most of Dragalia Lost will have opened up to you. There are now many paths forward as far as how to progress your account, and many means of growth. To explain how best to advance at this stage, I would sum it up in three simple words. Consistency is key. Almost all the events and modes in Dragalia Lost exist for some purpose and will provide useful inputs to your overall development, but logging in and playing, even grinding, regularly is most important of all. Your main goal after beating Chapter 7 is to build stronger and better teams and accumulate might, but to do so efficiently, you'll want to be cognizant of all the different modes in Dragalia, the timetable for quests as far as what to do daily, weekly, and monthly, and how Dragalia's mini upgrade systems work. As for why you'll want to power up your teams, well, it basically makes clearing early quests easier and allows you to challenge harder, more technical endgame battles that are some of the best in Dragalia Lost. You'll need teams of certain might values before you can unlock harder quests and modes. Might is just a heuristic number that rounds up your overall progress into one total. It's basically a full sum of your team's total strength, HP, node unlocks, equipment, shared skills, and so on, every ingredient in your team potentially contributes. Might should not be taken literally, nor is a higher might always better. From a long-term standpoint, the actual quality and nature of abilities and equipment matters far more than their might. But in the short term, you simply have to hit certain might milestones to even unlock new mid-game and end-game quests to begin with. It's purely a value for gating content and should be thought of as such. Note that other players can also use might to gate and restrict the rooms they create for co-op play. A common approach for progression is to start by building one single adventurer in each element. You can put these adventurers together for a beginner rainbow team, and that will be good enough to clear most standard difficulty solo content in the game. And since 5 elements exist, but only 4 adventurers can be used per team, you'll have the flexibility to sit one out. The other major advantage to having one strong unit per element is that for co-op play, it's usually only the one unit in the first slot of your team, or at most the units in the first two slots that enter battle. Yuden, Ronzel, Elisanne, and Cleo make for a solid core team. Luca or Mordecai can fill in when you need light units. All of these adventurers are available for free. When it comes to solo versus co-op play, you'll progress most rapidly if you participate in both. But for beginner and standard difficulty quests and certain game modes as a whole, co-op rooms can be tough to find. This is because most of the player base is concentrated on higher difficulty content. As a general rule of thumb, if a quest costs 25 or more stamina to play, then it's likely possible to find co-op lobbies. Anything that it costs less than that, and it's more likely that players will prefer to complete it in solo play. Early on, your player level increases rapidly, giving you lots of stamina and gather wings to expend freely. When possible, include a 5-star Yuden on your teams for 15% extra player EXP thanks to his unique ability, or just use player EXP boosting Worm Prince for an extra 10% instead. This will help you level up faster. Feel free to experiment and try lots of things out. Note that gather wings for co-op are harder to spend for the reason mentioned above. Players tend to concentrate on specific quests when it comes to co-op. Once you do have a strong adventurer for each element, the next step is typically to build a full team of 4 adventurers for each element. This is a much larger task since you're jumping from 5 total units up to 20. The good thing is there's an easy rule to follow as far as which element or elements to prioritize first. Typically, at any given time in Dragalia Lost, a special event will be active that favors one or at most 2 different elements. For the duration of that event, you should focus on developing adventurers of the element or elements advantaged by it. Special event types include raids, facility events, defensive battles, onslaught events, time attack challenges, story events, and coliseum events. They're all different, but the important note here is that usually the active special event features 1 or 2 elements of foes to defeat, and you're going to want to build up adventurers of the opposite elements to take them on. That's your signpost for which elemental team or teams to focus on at a given time in Dragalia Lost. As of late, each special event will usually bring with it smaller promotional events that double drops for quests that help you build up adventurers of the preferred elements for that special event. This makes it easy to see which elements you should try prioritize at a given time. Just look out for double drops. This is one reason you want to focus on the appropriate element for the moment, faster progression via double drops, but the other reason is that in the early game, you'll want teams of the right elements to even clear most of the event content itself. It's usually not too hard to get all rewards from a special event, but most do tend to have a few higher difficulty quests, and by building a properly matched team, you put yourself in the best possible position to clear that content even as a beginner to the game. Special events tend to run for around a week or two, and if you're not actively playing at the time and able to progress in the event, then you will miss out on some rewards. And even when old events are revived or added to the event compendium, veteran players can still collect from them. As a result, early adopters do have meaningful long-term advantages in Dragalia Lost, although this is offset somewhat by the game's design. Dragalia Lost, much like Cygames' flagship title Granblue Fantasy, is a slow burn. It tends to be less productive trying to burst through content rapid fire than it is just playing consistently. Special events tend to have some manner of incentive for daily play, like daily endeavors to accomplish. On top of these, raid and facility events have a nightmare difficulty that awards a grand bounty the first time you clear it daily. The bounty is a set of items, some of which are rare. Raids grant free adventurers, facility events provide stat boosting facilities, and defense and onslaught events give out elemental tomes, plus lots of honey used to refresh your stamina. Pretty much all types of events have their own story to top things off, and they give out precious and common items as rewards and drops as well. A typical month contains about 3 to 4 events or reruns, with the biggest of the bunch closing out the month. Besides special events and the campaign, Dragalia Lost also has a bunch of side content permanently available. On the quest tab below the main campaign, you should see headers for Avenue to Power, Avenue to Fortune, Elemental Ruins, the Events Compendium, the Mercurial Gauntlet, and Dragon Trials. After beating Chapter 6, you'll also see the Imperial Onslaught, and after Chapter 7, you'll see Void Battles. Some of these quests are intended for daily play, others offer monthly rewards, and some are just one and done. Sometimes you may also see quest headers for Astral Raids and the Alburian Battle Royale. Let's go through these modes based on frequency of play before going into more depth on progression. First, the daily quests. Avenue to Power drops mana and basic materials used to level up adventurers, dragons, and weapons. Avenue to Fortune drops lots of rupees. Elemental Ruins drops elemental orbs used to unbind the mana nodes of adventurers and upgrade elemental altars. The Dragon Trials drop dragon scales, which are also used for mana nodes and a few facilities in the Haladam. And the Imperial Onslaught drops insignias, tablets, and special coins used primarily for weapons weapon dojos, and core weapons. Each of these quests has daily bonus chests for the first clear per day or first two clears for Dragon Trials and the Imperial Onslaught. Try obtain all the bonus chests daily on the hardest difficulties you can and pick elements for the Elemental Ruins, Dragon Trials, and Imperial Onslaught with double drops active. For these quests, you only really want to do the easier difficulties once, and you generally don't want to actively farm these unless there's some type of promotion running like triple drops, or if you're absolutely bottlenecked from progressing a facility or adventurer's mana nodes that you really want to complete. Essentially, this is supplemental static content that gives you something to do every day in Dragalia Lost. Another form of daily quests are the Draconic Essences, available by playing main campaign quests on the hard and very hard difficulties. You unlock the hard difficulty after completing Chapter 10, and very hard is available after Chapter 14. Collect 50 Draconic Essences for a dragon, and you can spin them to unbind your copy of that same dragon once without needing or expending any duplicates of it. Essences are worth collecting if you already have the initial copy of a good dragon you're seeking to unbind, and if the story quests you're interested in have a promotion running such as double drops and half cost. If not, I'd suggest focusing on at most one dragon at once, since essences can cost lots of stamina to farm. Some other non-quest things you'll want to do every day are performing any free summons available for that day only, collecting a grand bounty from applicable special events as mentioned earlier, doing one free item summon, checking in with your alliance for goodies, even if it's only you in there, collecting rupees, dragon fruit, and honey tea from your Haladem, and gifting out everything available in the Dragon's Roost. Next, we come to weekly content. Besides endgame quests, which we'll discuss later, there are a few things to do each week in Dragalia Lost. First, most quests you clear will have a chance to drop Fafnir medals. You can collect up to a maximum of 50 per week, and they can be exchanged for valuable items in a treasure trade. As a new player, the first trades you should make for Fafnir medals are for the element neutral mini dragons, and all subsequent medals you get should go toward Champion's Testaments, those gold pieces of paper, until you completely exhaust their supply. As far as more weekly content, during weeks when there's no active raid events, an astral raid usually takes place during the weekend, bringing back a past raid boss. In order to play, you'll need to spend astral pieces that you can collect up to 300 of by clearing regular quests each weekday. By clearing astral raids when the weekend then rolls around, you earn astral shards that can be exchanged for valuable items in a monthly treasure trade. The last weekly mode is the Alberian Battle Royale, which tends to run Wednesday and Thursday. This is technically PvP, but each run is fresh with no ties to the main game, meaning it's a level playing field for anyone who wants to participate. This mode has its own treasure trade and battle milestones that you have an entire month to clear, but just like Astral Raids, I think of this more like weekly content because it's only around to play for a few days each week, even if the rewards are monthly. Battle Royale also happens to be an efficient way of farming up mana. It costs absolutely nothing other than time to play this mode, so it's a fantastic time sink and good means of collecting materials you need in mass via repeated runs. Next, the monthly quests. These include Void Battles and the Mercurial Gauntlet. They're always there, but both offer monthly rewards. Void Battles in the form of a monthly treasure trade that resets on the first of each month, and the Mercurial Gauntlet in the form of a monthly Victor's Trove that marks your total gauntlet level and pays out once per month on the 15th. The Mercurial Gauntlet is both a measure of your power in each element, as well as a means of progression, since you get rewards the first time you clear certain milestones. These rewards are on top of the overall trove each month. Of note, you aren't forced to bring one element here. Many times, off-element units and dragons do well. You also won't need to bring a healer in the early going, since you can use iframes to avoid all damage. Once you're caught up on the Mercurial Gauntlet, 60 floors per element at the time of recording, there's nothing else to actively do in this mode. It's more of a sandbag trial to test the DPS of your teams. You'll get the full-size Victor's Trove every month from that point on. Void Battles, in contrast, are quests you should play regularly and repeatedly. They have both static and monthly rewards. For new players, Void Battles are where you want to spend your excess stamina and Gether Wings after you've done your dailies. In particular, focus on Void Quests with double or triple drops active, especially the Chimera and Void Dragon Strikes. Of note, double drops are the norm for Void Battles, not the exception. Each week, every Void boss has at least one day where it gets double drops. The expert difficulty Void fights are most lucrative to farm, but you'll need the might to unlock them first. Once you do unlock expert void dragons and chimeras though, it's time to grind. I strongly suggest focusing on whichever void dragons and chimera have double drops to find active rooms. Until then, you should certainly clear each void quest at least once on every difficulty available simply for first clear endeavors. You should also prioritize trying to clear out the special tab of the void battle's treasure trait. The slime statues and gold Fafnirs from the special tab are crucial. Don't sell any copies of your gold Fafnir dragons. They're critical in the late game. In order to level up the slime facilities, you'll need a variety of void quest drops. Occasionally, you'll need to farm lower difficulty void battles if you want to unlock void abilities. But otherwise, expert void chimeras and void dragons should be your focus. That's because those quests on expert difficulty have the best drop rates for void seeds, the materials they drop are used for mana spirals and chimera tech weapons, and they also drop valuable augments. Access to chimera tech weapons which have excellent stats, and the ability to farm for more of them, is a strong indicator that you've moved beyond the early game into the mid game. With your teams capable of clearing almost all special event content, and some of the lower difficulty endgame content as well. And finally, as far as our overview of modes goes, that leaves us with the permanent side content found in the event compendium. Along with the harder difficulties of the main campaign, this is static content that's just there anytime you're ready to take it on. Each event in the compendium is one that happened before in Dragalia Lost. Outside of Draconic Essence farming, I'd say the event compendium is a higher priority than clearing out all of the hard and very hard campaign quests though, since each past event you finish from the compendium is going to grant you either a valuable stat boosting facility for facility events, or a brand new adventure for raid events. There is a lot to get through here though, and my recommendation is to do them when the element of the event aligns with whatever special event is active at the time. That way you'll be able to develop an extra facility from the compendium to help out for that particular element. Pretty much all the modes discussed are going to benefit you in some form or another as far as progress, but the key is once again just consistency. Try to do your dailies and stay on top of weeklies and monthlies too. Look toward whatever special event is active at the time you're playing as a guide for which element you should focus on developing, and make sure you collect all rewards from special events as those happen. Otherwise, if you need a further sense of direction, I'd say following Nott's Royal Regiment is probably the best approach to take in the early game. This can be accessed from the top right of the homepage, and it has really valuable rewards for completing various tasks called drills. The rewards include things like 5-star adventure and dragon vouchers, which let you pull a guaranteed 5-star at random from a small pool. The Royal Regiment is another way the game tutorializes its core systems, and you'll finish lots of it simply by playing the main campaign and trying out different permanent modes. The basic and intermediate drills in the Royal Regiment will teach you how to place and upgrade facilities in the Halidom, how to level up adventurers and unlock their mana nodes, and how to forge bonds with and level up dragons. They'll also give you your first taste of most of the aforementioned daily modes. The advanced drills are the point at which things pivot toward the mid-game, introducing void battles, and they culminate in your first look at the endgame, requiring clears of the Agito Uprising and High Dragon Trials. Even though the regimen lists clearing High Midgard Stormer's Trial before it lists clearing a Void Chimera battle, the latter is usually easier, in part because once you have a team with weapons crafted from the Chimera battles, you'll have a much easier time taking on High Midgard Stormer, especially with Void Banes. You'll also need to clear Chapter 9 and 10 of the campaign to finish the Royal Regimen, thereby unlocking the augment system, a further means of powering up your team's raw stats slowly. Spend your augments on the adventurers and worm prints you use most, and try not to reset them too often. The main campaign and Royal Regimen do a pretty good job presenting the core upgrade systems in Dragalia Lost, so rather than define how everything works, I'll try to elaborate with a few extra tips for each system. By upgrade systems here, I'm referring to everything on the upgrade slash crafting tab and parts of the castle tab. This includes facilities and the Halidom, weapons and crafting, worm prints, dragons, and adventurers. First, when it comes to the castle tab, this is where you'll find your Halidom and dragon's roost. Be sure to gift all of the available items in the roost to your dragons every day to forge bonds with them, since bonding not only extends your shapeshift duration, but it also grants wormite via dragon stories, and once your bond is maxed out with the dragon, you'll get a precious item called a sunlight ore. Now when it comes to the Halidom, the main tip I have is with respect to time management. Always be be constructing something using all your smith worms, of which I think it's worth getting all 5 or at least 4. Do not pay Wormite to speed up build times. Do use hustle hammers to speed up build times that take 1 or more days as you like. For the first 30 days you play Dragalia Lost, your build times will be halved. It takes a long time for everything, so focus on elemental and weapon facilities for your main teams first. Second, when it comes to crafting weapons, you're going to want to build a neutral element core 5-star weapon of each weapon type first, but don't rush to craft core elemental 5-star weapons. The neutral element core 5-star is all that's needed to craft Void and Chimera Tech weapons of the same type. There are basically two paths to the weapon system. Either craft core into Void into High Dragon weapons, or craft core into Chimera Tech into Agito weapons. The Chimera to Agito path tends to be better, but you may need a few Void weapons just to boost your might to even access Chimera battles in the first place. You can always return to Void and High Dragon weapons later on for the global abilities and bonuses available through them after you've obtained a variety of high stat Chimera Tech weapons. Unbind your weapons at most 5 times, with an exception for Void weapons, for which 6 unbinds is fine. 5 is the minimum number of unbinds you need to unlock a permanent global weapon bonus from a weapon, and in the long run, that's the main benefit of having weaker weapons in your collection once you unlock 6-star Agitos. My advice for Void weapons is 6 unbinds, because with 6 unbinds, you can also unlock a global ability for the element and weapon type called a High Dragon Bane that helps you in the endgame. That Bane is the last ability listed at the time of recording, and it gives you extra damage versus High Dragons. Rather than go for unbinds past 5 or 6, use your extra crafting materials to build out more weapons instead. You really don't need to have weaker weapons at a high level of unbinds, and I've seen lots of players get gummed up in their progress by continuously trying to unbind weaker weapons even when they're not used in the long run. Third, when it comes to Wormprints, do not rush to purchase these. Both Eldwater, used to buy them from the Wormprint shop, and even Consecrated or Blessed Water, used to raise Print HP and Strength, are scarce. Eldwater is certainly the harder to come by of the two, but unlike most other simple upgrade materials, Consecrated and Blessed Water, used to raise Wormprint stats, cannot be farmed in permanent quests. It's mainly obtained by playing special events. As a result, my main tip for Wormprints is just to use what you obtain via drops and by playing events, such as compendium events, for quite some time. Also note the max value on Wormprints. Similar abilities share a maximum cap across all slots on a given adventurer. The adventurer's personal abilities don't count against the cap shown on prints. Affinity bonuses, which provide might, by the way, also don't count against Wormprint ability caps. Something that confuses a lot of beginners is that related abilities on Wormprints don't have to have the exact same name to share the same max value or cap. For example, sword skill damage and regular skill damage share a cap of 40% across all your Wormprint slots on one adventurer. Don't run more than 40% just because the names are slightly different. You won't get any effect past 40% skill damage. The same is true of Flurry Strength plus 20%, HP 70% equals Strength plus 13%, and Full HP equals Strength plus 15%. All of these abilities share a cap of 20% strength in total across all print slots on an adventurer, so don't try go overboard here. This is one reason diversifying builds tends to be valued in Dragalia Lost, with the other being how the damage formula works. When in doubt, skill damage, strength, affliction punishers, and critical rate are usually solid abilities for attackers. Buffers and healers prefer abilities like skill prep, skill haste, buff time, and force charge, among others. Fourth, when it comes to dragons, well, some might say this is where rarity and power really intersect in Dragalia Lost. I advocate for how some of the best adventurers are of lower 3 to 4 star rarities, but the same cannot be said of dragons. Dragon power scales a lot with unbinding and rarity. Pretty much no new 3 to 4 star dragons ever release, and the ones that exist are almost all just role fillers for the early to mid game. That's not to say lower rarity dragons are bad, I'm just pointing out that the gacha is definitely at work here. You'll want to keep at least one copy of every dragon you obtain for your Dragon's Roost to forge bonds with for the rewards that grants, but from a practical standpoint, the only 4 stars you'd actually want to use in battle are basically just those who grant strength, Phoenix for emergency healing, and the Bronze and Silver Fafnirs for grinding. 4-star strength dragons provide 45% strength when max unbound, which is pretty respectable, until you start to unbind your better 5-star dragons. And even once you have a couple of good 5-star dragons, 4-stars can still be used to fill out the rest of your team and clear lots of quests absolutely fine. Even though all of the best dragons are 5-stars, there's quite a lot of power variation at the 5-star rarity as well. Some dragons like Styx are really bad despite being rare, but others like Gala Mars or the Easter Bunny dragon Gauna and Krenna are exceptional. The optimal dragons for most attackers grant lots of skill damage like 90% or more, or a high amount of strength like 70 to 80%. For support units, skill haste or utility effects like those found on Freya, Popstar Siren, and the aforementioned Bunny work well. As a new player, I'd suggest unbinding 4-stars while holding on to every 5-star dragon you pull as separate copies. Remember, you won't have to spend dupes to unbind 5-star dragons whose Draconic Essences are available, and what's available via Essences is constantly being updated. So, until you can max unbind the dragon, it's probably better to have the separate copies. It may mean you can max unbind multiple copies of that dragon in the end instead. And finally, when it comes to adventurers, well, take it slow and focus on a few at a time. In the early game, you're going to acquire new adventurers at a much faster rate than you can build them all. Much of what you summon will consist of new units, but unlocking mana nodes requires mana and materials which you won't have in abundance. As mentioned earlier, try build one strong unit in each element first, then build a team of 4 in each element, and always stop at 40 mana nodes for the early game at most. This is because unlocking the final mana circle and its nodes costs precious materials, including Eldwater and Champion's Testament, and it's much better to save those resources until you've gotten slightly more experience to have confidence in the adventurers you're investing in. The same is true with spending elemental tomes on shared skills or trying to unlock mana spirals. These are costly choices which can be done in time, but there's no need to rush them down early. 40 mana nodes at most, and 21 mana nodes minimum to read adventurer stories for Wyrmite is safe. I'd also advise against promoting any 3 to 4 star adventurers in the early game, just because the Eldwater you'll need to do so can be so hard to come by. Some are totally worth it, like Karina, Patia, or Templar Hope, but they may not shine until later on. Using your resources carefully is especially important for free-to-play players. Dragalia Lost is extremely generous, giving more than what you need to clear content, but not so generous that you can have it all. Ah, summoning, a quintessential element of any gacha, with Dragalia Lost being no different. Dragalia Lost is a relatively generous game when it comes to summoning currencies, but exactly how many free-to-play pulls it gives out has oscillated over time, with recent months averaging near 200. All quests in Dragalia Lost can be cleared without utilizing the gacha, and there are lots of good welfare and lower rarity units who are relatively accessible. Still, summoning is a major motivator for some players, and what summons can be very strong, so I felt like it was important to discuss this as its own topic. My overall advice for new players is to try take a conservative tack when it comes to saving up summoning resources. In Dragalia Lost, summoning can be done with 3 different currencies: summon vouchers, Wyrmite, and Diamantium. Vouchers and Wyrmite are obtained for free, while Diamantium is paid only. Vouchers come in single and tenfold varieties, and a single summon costs 120 Wyrmite or Diamantium to perform, with the tenfold costing 1200 but guaranteeing at least one 4-star adventurer or dragon. As for other means of summoning, there's a lower cost paid summon called the Daily Deal that can be done once a day for 30 Diamantium, and there are also some special types of summon vouchers technically speaking, ones that guarantee a 5-star adventure or dragon at random from a small pool, for example. At times, Dragalia Lost will also run Use It or Lose It, free daily singles or tenfolds, which you must log in and redeem the day of. For instance, this happens every day for the first week that new players start playing the game. A common question I get from new players is, how do you have so much Wyrmite? Or, how can I farm Wyrmite? The premise behind this question is usually that the player who's asking wants to summon more than they're currently able to. And the truth is, there is no magic secret, it just comes down to saving. Firing off tenfold summons at random as soon as you get enough resources to do so is costly in the long run. As for how Wyrmite can be obtained though, there are more sources than some players may realize. first clear endeavors for all quests, including those in the event compendium, and on all difficulties of the campaign, grant Wormite. Reading stories, including event, campaign, adventurer, dragon, and castle stories, all grant Wormite. Getting duplicate facilities or epithets during event reruns grants Wormite. Login bonuses grant Wormite. Normal and limited endeavors found on the homepage often grant Wormite. And less common Wormite sources include dev team gifts, co-op social reward resets, and player level ups. There are several different types of summon showcases you can spend your summoning resources on, with typically no more than 1 to 3 available at once. Among these, it's worth differentiating between regular, gala, and platinum showcases. Regular showcases have a 4% starting appearance rate for 5 stars. Sometimes the units featured will be limited time, or each pull will come with a prize item, or every pull will be of a certain element. But at a high level, these are all just variants on a regular 4% type of showcase. Among the 4% showcases, limited time showcases are often called seasonal, those with prize items are called prize showcases, and those which focus on one element are called focus showcases. Moving on from these 4% showcases, we come to galas. Gala showcases have a 6% base appearance rate for 5 stars, and they feature either a new gala adventurer or dragon, or they're a remix returning a past gala unit, often with other 5 stars also given a raid up. Gala units are usually strong and can't be pulled outside of gala showcases, with rare exceptions. And finally, platinum showcases are paid-only summon showcases which require spending diamantium, but in turn guarantee a 5 star on every tenfold summon. These are generally considered to be bait, because which 5 star you get in a platinum showcase is random among a pool of eligible 5 stars. In some cases, the pool is small enough to be okay though. As far as types of showcases, galas tend to be the preferred place to summon, especially for beginners, since higher rates for 5 stars as a whole make them excellent for expanding your collection. In particular, gala showcases which feature gala dragons are usually awesome, since gala dragons range from good to great, they're usually worth unbinding, and they're a means to endgame power even when using adventurers who are on the weaker side. Galas aren't particularly great for sniping units fast though, and you should never try target something that doesn't have an appearance rate up. Sometimes non-gala showcases can be worth pulling on too. It all comes down to how much you want whoever is featured, whether or not they're limited, and the extent to which they can help you clear new content or do something truly unique and difficult to replace. That last consideration could include things like letting you solo a high difficulty quest or enabling you to auto-battle a quest you otherwise could not with your existing teams. When it comes to deciding whether or not to summon, you should always be thinking about what the units who are featured can actually do for you materially in terms of gameplay. Also critical to consider when summoning is how many pulls you have in reserve, because Dragalia Lost uses a sparking system. Once you've done 300 free-to-play summons on a showcase or 150 paid pulls or any combination thereof, you can pick an eligible adventure or dragon of your choice guaranteed. Setting aside enough summoning currency and saving is crucial if you want to remain free to play. You'll have plenty of adventurers to build and invest in regardless, from your week of starting summons alone, but you get much more mileage out of infrequent large summoning sessions than short, frequent ones. Besides its sparking or worm sigil system, Dragalia Lost also uses a pity rate system to boost your chance of a 5 star for every 10 summons you do without one. When you do get a 5 star, your pity rate resets, but this means any 5 star, not just the ones featured at an appearance rate up on a given showcase, so sparking is much more secure. Some players will want a stash of 300 pulls before they start to summon in earnest so they can spark in the worst case. For others, 100 or 60 pulls at once are enough, since regular and gala banners guarantee some kind of 5 star after that many respective pulls, thanks to the pity rate system. As far as the pity rate system goes, the most important thing to note is that the way rates are set is such that you should always do single summons before a tenfold when targeting a unit. I suggest doing 20 singles before you start tenfolds, then rinsing and repeating once you break your pity rate. This allows you to build a pity rate which will then apply to the full circle when you tenfold summon. When you summon summon on a showcase in Dragalia Lost, be sure to check the appearance rate tabs to confirm which units actually have a raid up. This doesn't always match what's on the picture for the showcase. Also check the Worm Sigil list to see which adventurers and dragons are eligible for sparking, which can differ from who is featured on the showcase at an appearance raid up. Also remember that any leftover Worm Sigils used for sparking expire when the showcase ends, and they won't cross over toward any other showcases. Instead, they expire into Worm Sigil remnants, and those remnants can be used in a treasure trade, from which you should really only consider getting Champion's Testaments. And speaking of Champion's Testaments, now let's talk about saving more broadly when it comes not just to summoning, but other precious resources as well. These golden pieces of parchment are used to unlock the final few nodes of an adventurer's mana circles, and they're used in mana spirals. They're among the rarest items in the game when considering that building a spiraled 5-star adventurer from scratch costs 7 of them, building a 4-star costs 3, and building a 3-star takes 2. Even adventurers who lack a spiral will need 3 Champion's Testaments at 5-star, or 1 if they're a 4-star or 3-star adventurer. Knight's Testaments, a silver piece of parchment, are needed for lower rarity units, but they're far more abundant than Champion's Testaments. Besides Champion's Testaments, the next most restricted item you'll need to enhance adventurers is Eldwater, which you can obtain when you summon duplicate adventurers, receive duplicate worm prints from quest drops, through endeavors, and by other means. As mentioned when discussing units and prints, Eldwater is scarce, meaning you want to be selective with which units you promote and fully upgrade. Elemental tomes, used to unlock shared skills, are also rare, with around 10 to 12 distributed per month. The time will come to use these, but there's no need to do so for early or mid-game content. So, save up. Outside of Testaments, Tomes, and Eldwater, Sunlight Stones are the next most precious item. Each one is a free unbind on a 5-star dragon of your choice, so never use these on welfare dragons or ones who can be unbound using draconic essences. Be sure to save them for Gala or Limited dragons most of the time. Otherwise, Damascus and Adamantine ingots are also rare. Hang on to these for core weapon unbinds and the 5th to 8th unbinds of Agito weapons, respectively. Twinkling Sands, much like Champion's Testaments, are another rare material you get more of steadily from events. Save these for crafting Agito weapons when you're starting off, and eventually use them for core weapons. Then there are Golden Keys. Use these for the 2nd to 4th unbinds on 5-star worm prints obtained from the shop or from drops. All the items just discussed are ones you should prioritize clearing out from treasure trades. Usually, if you see less than 10 of one item in an event treasure trade, it probably means it's limited or precious in some way. This is also why keeping up with special events is important. They're the only ways to obtain a lot of these precious items regularly. There are also fragment type items called Sunlight Ore, Damascus Crystals, Golden Fragments, and Twinkling Grains, which can be traded 10 for 1 for stone, ingots, keys, and sands. The more you play Dragalia Lost, the better feel you'll get for what's scarce and what's common. In the early game, it can feel like you're short on every type of material used for crafting and mana nodes. Everything feels hard to come by, but with enough play and enough time, other than the special items just mentioned, you'll eventually have plenty of materials such that you can immediately build new adventurers and fully level dragons as soon as you acquire them. One last thing to note when it comes to saving and summoning is another use for Diamantium and Wormite. Both can be used to refresh stamina or gather wings, and thereby farm more than normal. I don't recommend this since I find most players prefer to summon than to farm, but just know that there are players out there who prefer to repeatedly refresh their stamina and gather wings rather than summon in order to farm and finish new endgame quests as soon as they release. Saving and grinding can take a long time. Dragalia Lost is full of content that's meant to be repeated, but if you prefer not to rush toward endgame quests, you can always take things slow. Many players enjoy the game most casually, taking in new events and reading new stories as they come in, summoning for characters with appealing designs or fun play patterns, and just vibing to the game's music and visuals. For those who are looking for more of a challenge though, Dragalia Lost delivers with its endgame trials. these are the most intricately designed and action-packed battles of the quests on offer in Dragalia Lost. The endgame content of Dragalia Lost tests your mastery of combat, meaning dodging and timing skills, attacking with minimal disruptions to your combo rotations, and understanding boss tells and patterns. It also rewards game knowledge and optimized team building, having a meaningful set of worm prints, a unit whose kit works well for a given trial, and intentionality to each build choice you make is beneficial. And of course, there's also an element of pure raw stats. The higher your facilities are in level, the more augments you have, and the more invested your gear is, the easier a time you'll have in the endgame. The exact stats benchmark you'll want to hit before you're quote-unquote ready to take on the endgame varies. Most of the time, the psychological barrier is bigger than the stats barrier because advanced players with the patience to do so have demonstrated many endgame quests can be completed with significantly under-geared units. There's also a wide range of difficulty within the endgame itself, so the standard for readiness increases as quests get harder and harder. The suggested might needed to unlock a quest is usually the minimum and not actually indicative of quest difficulty. Therefore, it probably makes most sense to go through the specific quests themselves one by one. The endgame can be broadly split into High Dragon Trials, the Agito Uprising, and a special raid battle called Morsayati Reckoning, at least at the time of recording. Additional endgame battles are planned for Spring 2021, so those may have released by the time you're watching this, but I can't speak on them. The High Dragon Trials have 4 difficulties from Prelude to Master, and consist of 5 trials, one for each element. The Agito Uprising, likewise, covers all 5 elements and has 4 difficulties, with the hardest difficulty Legend not currently released for all elements at the time of recording. Legend difficulty Agito quests and the Morsayati Reckoning raid are both considered exceptionally difficult according to the game's developers, and as such, they're listed separately on the quest menu. They also only grant 1 weekly bonus per week, compared to the 5 bonuses available for regular Agito battles and High Dragons. This is another form of weekly content, and these bonus chests work much like they do for the daily bonuses found on basic quests like Avenue to Fortune, Elemental Ruins, and so on. And speaking of Avenue to Fortune, well, all endgame battles drop lots of rupees, 100,000 at base rates before Gold Fafnir's, except for the Prelude difficulty of the High Dragons, which, to be frank, is hardly endgame in terms of its challenge. Many players think Avenue to Fortune is the best place to farm rupees, but standard difficulty High Dragons and Agito quests, along with double drop and triple drop expert void battles, actually offer better rates. In the case of void battles, it's because you can trade void seeds into leaves into rupees at good rates. This is a way the game incentivizes you to focus on harder content as you strengthen your teams. In addition to rupees, endgame quests also drop materials used for crafting weapons and for obtaining and leveling up new facilities. High Dragon materials can also be exchanged for copies of the High Dragons themselves. The weapons you can craft from High Dragon Trials and the Agito Uprising are stronger than Chimera Tech weapons, and these will help outfit you for future endgame quests and harder special event quests like Trials and Omega Raids. Otherwise, the main reason to collect them is simply the joy of seeing bigger numbers on your adventurers, meaning higher stats and more damage in battle. Not to mention, the weapons look pretty cool to boot. Because Agito weapons are stronger than High Dragon weapons, you can leapfrog High Dragon weapons relatively easily if you wish to do so, instead choosing to use High Dragon materials on dragon-centric facilities called Dracoliths and Fafnir statues in the short run and returning to the weapons later on. As a whole, the High Dragon trials were made significantly easier with more obvious tells and visual cues during the second anniversary of Dragalia Lost, so let's start there. Don't be afraid to give them a try. The standard and expert difficulties of the High Dragon trials are identical mechanically, but expert has higher stats than standard. Having an on-element team with Chimera Tech weapons and max unbound 4-star dragons or 5-star dragons with no unbinds should leave you well positioned to solo these battles, but in truth, this difficulty and above tends to be easier to get your clears in co-op than in solo, since for co-op you just need 1 or 2 well-built adventurers. I'd say you want your facilities to be around level 16 or so, with higher being better. The standard difficulty can help you learn most of the early mechanics in each battle, while Expert can pose more of a challenge and could require some trial and error to learn the cadence of each fight. If you have the appropriate High Dragon Bane on your weapons, unlocked globally from Void Weapons with 6 Unbinds, then these quests are significantly easier, because you get a flat 30% damage increase. If I had to rank each battle, I'd go High Mercury, High Midgard Sormer, then Jupiter, Zodiark, and Brunhilde, from easiest to hardest. These fights also introduce concepts like baiting enemy attacks and force you to think about your team composition to a greater degree. For example, for several of these battles, the adventurer standing closest to the boss will be targeted, so having multiple melee units can make it hard to predict who the boss will attack. Another thing you'll learn by playing these battles in solo is how to manipulate your AI teammates. A common technique is to disengage the boss, running away until your lead unit loses the targeting reticle, to ensure your AI drop everything and follow you, during which time they become much better at dodging. There's also lots of other little subtleties to each specific trial that I won't dive into here. It's fun experiencing them for yourself and mastering them over time. And speaking of mastery, well, master difficulty for the High Dragon trials is basically just a remix of each fight with higher stats. If you want to craft and upgrade High Dragon weapons, you'll need to do a mix of each difficulty over time. The Agito Uprising is the other set of endgame fights. These are harder than the High Dragons, although the standard difficulty is relatively accessible in co-op. If a strong player joins your lobby, they can carry the quest by themselves without much trouble. I would say for Agito quests, you probably want most of your facilities around level 30, and you do want to have a strong Chimera Tech weapon with a 5-star dragon on the adventure you're using. Expert difficulty Agito quests may appear similar to their standard difficulty counterparts, but I'll simply say, give them a try without looking them up first. They are full of surprises, and master difficulty Agito quests are genuinely pretty hard. Mistakes can be punishing, and you'll need to react to enemy attacks fairly quickly. Whereas the High Dragons follow a fixed sequence of moves, Agito battle patterns fluctuate depending on how much damage you deal to the bosses. Sometimes entire sections of the fight can be skipped, so there's more variation in what you actually see, and you will feel a difference as you power up. There's still a cadence to each Agito fight to learn and master, but I would say the fights are more dynamic overall. As far as difficulty, I think Ciela is probably the easiest Agito battle, followed by Kai Yan, then Tartarus, then the twins Ayaha and Atoha, and finally Volk is the hardest, at least on standard and expert difficulties. Note that how hard each battle is can vary a lot, and nowadays explosive strategies do exist to trivialize some of the battles I've listed as harder here, but I'm talking mechanical complexity for a first timer. The co-op and solo variants of each battle also vary in difficulty. Kai Yan and Ciela are known, for example, for being easy to auto-battle with enough investment. The twins are in the middle, Volk is difficult, and Tartarus is considered very difficult to auto-battle at the time of recording, in part because adventurers do not automatically shapeshift into dragons, which is a core mechanic in Tartarus's fight. There are some workarounds and speed clears, often called cheese clears though, but many times speed comps involve specific adventurers and worm prints which are out of reach for beginners. In the endgame, you may be tempted to copy and paste others' builds or use tier lists to decide which adventurers to invest in. Just be careful if you go this route. Sometimes the builds you see out there used for speedruns require extremely high facility levels and investment to pull off, or otherwise need a lot of coordination. And what seems to you like substituting or tweaking one tiny little thing can actually make a huge difference in success rates. In addition, there's a lot of old info out there, including old videos on my own channel, in part because the game underwent major rebalancing during its second anniversary. So be careful. All of that said, with respect to co-op, there is a meta in the sense that public lobbies do tend to cluster toward one or two popular strategies, and playing less popular characters or ones who don't fit neatly into those strategies can make your life more difficult if you aren't matchmaking with friends in a private room. If you have trouble finding a home for your particular adventurer when seeking groups, you may wish to seek help on Discord. It's not that your adventurer can't clear. It's more that in public groups, players are seeking fast and consistent runs that fit the molds they're used to. That's in part because, as with Dragalia Lost's early and mid-game quests, its endgame quests also require a lot of repeated play to accumulate resources, to craft endgame weapons, and level up endgame facilities. That's basically Dragalia Lost's core gameplay loop. Continuously power up to face harder content, to power up to face harder content in the future. I don't want want to get into too much more detail on either the High Dragons or Agito Uprising, since we're past the early and mid game at this point. Legend difficulty and more Sayari Reckoning are also beyond the scope of this guide. I've uploaded several other videos on the channel to share gameplay footage of those fights, as have other content creators and Dragalia Lost community members, so whenever you're ready to take the endgame on, doing a bit of research beforehand never hurts. There are a lot of valuable resources out there, and the Dragalia Lost community is very welcoming toward new players. Besides the game's wiki, which I mentioned at the onset of this guide, other popular tools include the game's DPS simulator and custom sim, crafting calculators and spreadsheet templates to plan long-term projects, and more. In addition to the mid-sized Discord server I operate, the game's subreddit runs a large Discord server with a humongous player base, if that's more your speed. I'll be sure to link to both in the description below. And alright, we've covered a ton in this video, from the early game story tutorials to your first steps into the late game. I hope this video helps newer players navigate the variety of quests and the mini systems in Dragalia Lost, with an emphasis on enabling them to ramp up quickly so they're able to tackle limited time special events and collect all the goodies contained therein soon after they start playing this game. If you have any more tips for new players, please leave them in the comments below. There's so much to this game that making a comprehensive guide is almost impossible, but I hope this provides a good starting point if Dragalia Lost has you feeling lost. Otherwise, everyone, that is going to do it for this video. Thank you so much for watching, take care, and I'll see you next time.